Yeah, in practice, one of the best ways you can improve the performance of your model is really just to focus on the dataset itself before you do anything more fancy. So in this video, I want to briefly talk about two ways for improving the performance by focusing on the dataset. One is by collecting more data, and the other is by augmenting the data that you already have. So how do you know whether more data could be good for your model? So there is a technique called learning curves, or the techniques, or let's say the method is called making a learning curve. And how does that work? So here I'm showing you an example where I made a learning curve for a softmax classifier using the M, or a subset of the MNIST dataset. So why the softmax classifier? That was, when I made this, it was just quick because softmax is faster to train than a multilayer perceptron. So that was more like for efficiency reasons, but this should work for any type of neural network to help you find out whether more data is useful. So what you can see here is on the x-axis different training set sizes. So I was changing the size of the training set that I used for training the softmax classifier. So I was varying it from here, it's maybe around 100 training examples, up to here, it's around 3,500 training examples. I was changing the size of the training set, but I was keeping the test set size constant. So I was using the same exact same test set, just different models because the training set sizes were different. So in the beginning, so let's just briefly talk about the training set accuracy to get it out of the way. So you can see that the training accuracy goes down when we add more data. So why is that? I mean, this is like a little bit unintuitive, and this does not always happen. I think here it's just because it's such a simple model. So if you have a very small data set, actually, it's easy to overfit the data. So you will always find, if you have a very small data set, that you have high accuracy, and then it goes down. But usually it also, it might go up again if you have more data. So I wouldn't pay too much attention here on the training set accuracy. What's actually more interesting is that the test set accuracy goes up, right? So that is what we want to see. And here you can also see here, the gap between training and test set performance shrinks. So whether the training accuracy stays constant or not doesn't really matter. What's really mattering here is that the test set accuracy goes up, and just by that fact, even if the training set here would be constant, we would reduce overfitting. So in that way, we don't know really what happens beyond 3,500, right? So we have no idea what's going to happen in, let's say, in this region between 3,500 and 5,000, or even beyond that. But just by looking at this slope here, if you just look at that slope, you can, you can just argue or imagine that the performance might even improve further beyond here. So here, it might just be a good idea to just collect more data. So for instance, if this is like really what's going on, then by just collecting 1,000 more training examples, you could already increase the performance from, let's say, 91% to maybe up to 93% here. So it's 2% points in this very high region here already. But of course, this is only speculating, but sometimes adding more data helps, and this can be diagnosed by making such learning curves. One thing I should say, though, is maybe you shouldn't use the test set for doing that, because you should only use the test set ideally once at the very end. So instead of using the test set, you may want to use the validation set. So in the previous lectures, we always used the validation set during training. It's usually a better idea to not use the test set. So just wanted to clarify that. Okay. That would be one way of finding out whether more data helps. The other topic for this video is looking at data augmentation, like modifying the data that you have already. So here at the top, I'm showing you again a snapshot from MNIST. So here are just some example images from MNIST. And at the bottom, I'm showing you randomly augmented versions of that. So what you can see is here, they are slightly zoomed in. But moreover, you can also see this one is slightly rotated to the left compared to this one. So these are really pairs. This is slightly rotated to the right, and so forth. So I'm creating modified versions. So why would I do that? So those can really help the network to not memorize exact pixel locations, right? Because, for instance, it might memorize, these two, some locations here, just memorizing them. But if you randomly rotate it, it can't exactly memorize these locations. It has to learn more than just these locations. It has to more learn the shape or at least a couple of more locations, right? Because it can't always rely on these positions. It has to learn the relationship between these positions. So in that way, data augmentation can be a cheap way of helping with the generalization performance. So I don't want to go into too much detail, making a new video for the code notebook, because that would maybe take too much time and it's not necessary, because it's actually pretty straightforward and I can describe this here, I think, on that single slide. If you want, though, I have the whole code example here on GitHub, which you should be able to run just from there. I will also post the link on Canvas, of course. So recall in the last week's lecture, we talked about these custom data loaders, where we used a data set. So here I'm showing you again this data set. But last week, when we did that, we used a simple transformation here as the argument for transform. We used toTensor, which is just converting an image into a PyTorch tensor. Now we are using a fancier version. We call it training transforms. And training transforms is shown here on the top, so let's discuss that first. So we are using a library called TorchVision for that, and this one should already be installed when you installed PyTorch. So if you go to pytorch.org and execute the installation command, you may have noticed that it already included TorchVision. So here, what you can see is that we are using TorchVision, the transforms submodule, and there's a compose class, which lets us chain different or multiple transformations. So here I'm just showing you a selection of those, but there are of course more of them that you may find online here on this website. There's a whole bunch of those. So here I'm using resize, random crop, random rotation, and then the toTensor and normalization. So let's talk about them one by one. So resizing, so MNIST images are 28 by 28. Here I'm resizing it, making them slightly larger, and then cropping them back to 28, 28. This is essentially zooming in or cropping a random region from that image. So why am I doing that? I mean, it's not always helpful. In the case of MNIST, it's maybe not always such a good idea because it's not technically necessary. But if we do that consistently for both the training and test set, if we zoom in both, then this is essentially similar to translating the image. So moving it slightly to the left and to the right and top and bottom. Because I should say for it, we'll talk about the test transformation in a second. Let's finish the training set transformation. So we do the resizing, the random crop, and then I do also a random rotation. So here up to 30 degrees, so minus 30 degrees to the left, up to minus 30 degrees to the right. So this is randomly. Sometimes it's a small value, sometimes there may be no rotation, so it's really random. So this helps us like really almost creating infinitely many new flavors of our existing images. I'm using this interpolation here. It's not ideal either, but it's better than the default. So you can see it looks a little bit blurry, but it has also something to do with zooming. But if you don't do that, you will see these images are a little bit more, I would say, jagged. So the edges are a little bit more jagged. So in that way, there's no ideal way. I find this one is slightly better than the default, but this is really up to you which one you use. You can also actually ignore that if you like. Then we are converting. So during these steps, the data is still in an image format. Here it's then converted to a PyTorch tensor. And by default, toTensor will, like we discussed, will normalize the images such that they are in a 0-1 range. But for gradient descent, it might be better to have unit variance and zero mean, so having them standardized. So how can we do that? So there's a normalize transform here, so where we can choose a mean and a standard deviation. So in this case, because we know the data range for each feature, it's the same. It's the pixel values between 0 up to 255, or in that case, if we normalize them between 0 and 1, what we can do is we can choose 0.5 as the mean and 0.5 as the standard deviation, and then the images will be afterwards in the minus 1 to 1 range. So why is that? Standardization works like that. If we have an input feature, or let's say this is our normalized feature, it's a pixel position, and then we subtract for this given pixel the mean over the pixels, over all the pixels in the data set in this position. So let's call that feature J, and this is the mean for feature J, and then we divide it by the standard deviation for feature J. And this will give us a unit variance and zero mean, so standard deviation of 1. Here we are choosing these values such that we have a zero mean, but a standard deviation also of 1. So that is what we are going to do here. So the images will be in the range minus 1 to 1, because the largest value is 1. So 1, let's do it slowly. 1 minus 0.5 is 0.5 divided by 0.5 is 1, right? So, and if the input pixel is 0, 0 minus 0.5 divided by 0.5 is minus 1. So they will be in the range between minus and 1 in this case. All right, so this is how we could augment our input images for the training, but we have to be careful now for the test set. We don't want any randomness in the test set, right? So here we are doing things randomly. We don't want any randomness usually in the test set. So here I was actually, for the test transforms, I was removing all the random parts. However, because I used resizing and random crop, I also should use them in the test set to have things consistent. Otherwise, all the test set images will look smaller than during training, which might not be ideal. So here I'm using the resize, but I'm using a center crop. So it's cropping the region in the center rather than randomly. So if I go back one slide, for instance, it's hard to see here, but they're almost like center cropped here. But so this one is maybe slightly to the left. So if that was a testing image, it would might be more to the left here. So in that way, we avoid randomness here. Okay. And like I said, we are providing the training transforms to the data set here and the test transforms to the test set here. And we would also use the test transforms for the validation set. All right. So I should maybe also add, we only have one color channel for MNIST. So if we work with RGB images, we want to also make sure that we do the standardization for each color channel. So if we have RGB, we would have three of these values. In practice, people also sometimes compute the mean and standard deviation over the whole data set by themselves, basically, for each channel. But that is a little bit more work, so you can do that. Sometimes people also use these statistics from the ImageNet data set, but in practice I find it makes only a small difference whether you use the actual mean and standard deviation of the data set or you just use these placeholder values. All right, so these were like two ways you can improve the performance by just looking at the data set, that is by plotting these learning curves and augmenting existing data. In the next video I want to show you how early stopping works. Just illustrating the concept of early stopping. We have briefly seen that or discussed that already in the previous week when we talked about double descent. But I just want to recap for completeness how early stopping works.